I'm Dan, Chief Instructor at DW Aviation, a boutique flight training service provider in the Phoenix Valley, and today we're going to learn how to do a pre-flight walkaround on a Cessna Skyhawk. The Skyhawk behind me here in the hangar is the Aviation Explorer Post 352, and I volunteer my time as a volunteer flight instructor, as do all of our instructors. The Post 352 is great for people in Arizona because it's a low-cost flight training option for youth ages 14 through 20. So a lot of my students here through the Post are actually still in high school, and by the time they graduate, they will have a private pilot certificate and be well on their way to an airline career or just a really, really fun hobby. So it is absolutely paramount that the stuff that we teach here is in line with the FAA, that translates well into careers, and also is just a very, very fun experience. So for more information about the Aviation Explorers, go to aviationexplorerpost352.com. You can learn all about it, or you can also come down to Falcon Field, find flyers, and come join us at the next Aviation Explorer event. If you want to join and your age is 14 through 20, please get in touch with the club. It would be great having you here, and it's a really great introduction to the community here in aviation. So, that being said, we're going to take a look at a Cessna Skyhawk. I have hundreds of hours in these. It's one of my favorite aircraft to fly, but just as paramount as having a good time and learning proper knowledge is safety, and airworthiness is the biggest one before you even take off. You're never required to take off on an aircraft, but due to physics, the aircraft always has to land one way or the other. So our goal with a pre-flight is to make sure that it's landing in the safest way possible and that the entire flight profile is not only safe but is legal as well. So the first thing we do is run a checklist. Checklists are crucial in aviation, even if we've got hundreds of hours in the Skyhawk and it's a fairly simple aircraft. The reason checklists exist is to then verify that we've done everything in the correct order and everything that needs to be done. There are people who don't use checklists, and that's unfortunately why general aviation, one of the reasons why general aviation has such a high accident rate, because it could just be simple things that you forget. Not checking weather, not checking your performance, not checking weight and balance. So that's all on the checklist here at the Aviation Explorers. Your Skyhawk should have a checklist. If it does not have a printed checklist, look in your pilot operating handbook because it will almost certainly be there. That being said, let's hop into the airplane, let's actually get a checklist, and let's start running. The first thing we have to do before we go flying is check the airworthiness of this aircraft. That is the legal requirements being met. So there are a few things that you should look for. Now, by now, everybody should know the aero checklist. So airworthiness, registration, your radio certificate for the station if you're flying internationally, your operating handbook, so the pilot operating handbook, the POH, and typically you can find that in the back of the seat. And then also the W stands for weight and balance. In this aircraft, that's a separate folder right here. So verify that you have those, and we'll just go through this right now. So the airworthiness document is first. That's typically in the side pocket, right below the checklist down here on the side. And what we're looking for, standard airworthiness certificate. This is a Cessna 172 mic model, and we are verifying that that is in fact this tail number. That is in fact this serial number, which you can find on the data plate. You're verifying the tail number, so 92855, that is the correct aircraft. That is the correct airworthiness certificate. It's in good condition, and its designation number is the Scottsdale FISDO, so that's great. The date of issuance on these, you will notice, is often a long, long time ago. This one is from 1973. It's up to the pilot in command to verify airworthiness of the aircraft every single flight prior to flying, but the certificate itself does not have an expiration date. This is FAA form 8100-2, if you want to look that up. If you have a problem, your airworthiness certificate is torn or faded, it's fairly simple to request a new one from the FAA. You just go to faa.gov and walk through that process for aircraft owners. So we've got that. The next thing is registration that is in this pocket, and that typically it's registered to the flying club, and that's going to be for, here's the Department of Transportation, Federal Aviation Administration, so this is the federal registration. But then in Arizona, you also need a registration for the specific aircraft and the state. So this is the Arizona registration. So you need two separate registrations. So here we're verifying County of Maricopa, Arizona Motor Vehicle Division. We have that and it is valid. This expires the last day of this year. So we're good to go. This one for the government, we look always at the expiration date, and that's valid until July 31st, 2023, which is in 2 years from now. Almost to the day. So we are good to go on this aircraft. The registration that we have to worry about more recently is the Arizona registration expiring in 1 year. But for today's flight, we're good to go. Next thing is we are looking at, we got our airworthiness right here. We got our registration, right? So the next thing we have to do is obviously put these back, but then we're looking for the radio station certificate, and that will be typically in your POH or in your dispatch binder, but we're not flying internationally today, so we don't need one. So moving on now to operating handbook, POH. The POH has to be in the aircraft at all times. So if you've got a digital copy of your POH with the tail number, the serial number of that aircraft, if you have a digital copy, a lot of people do that. You just have to be able to have access to the original paper copy, especially for a check ride. You always need the paper copy. Again, quick and easy access, performance calculations, looking at systems diagrams, things like that, just flipping through weight and balance performance charts, things like that. Next is the weight and balance. And for this aircraft's weight and balance, we're looking at a couple things. The first thing we're looking at, again, we're verifying that it's the same tail number, 92855, Cessna 172 Mike. So that's great. Then we're looking at the date that this was issued. This was issued in August of 2020. Now we're looking to make sure that it hasn't been superseded. So you flip through and you see, you can verify this in the, typically in your logbooks for the aircraft, if there was any equipment installed or there was a new weight and balance done, you'll see that. You're looking to make sure that that form has not been superseded. And you can see going back, these forms all are older and have been superseded. This one is from way back in 2005, and then you start to get the discolorations from the original 1970s era weight and balance in Wichita, Kansas. So these are all in there. You're looking for the most recent one. If it says superseded anywhere on there, it is not current. If you have installed new equipment, like say a GPS where there wasn't one before, and it requires a new weight and balance and you don't have one, the weight and balance is not current. So we're checking current weight and balance. And then again, this is how we do our flight planning. So once that's done and we verified the aircraft legal airworthiness on that front, then we can move into the actual pre-flight procedures. So then we can grab a checklist, and there's also one here for the Aviation Explorers on that side. And we're gonna start doing our initial check. The initial check, the first thing to do is get your weather or your ATIS information. So just to save some money for people renting and Aviation Explorers especially, one thing you can do rather than start up all the avionics and be billed for the Hobbs time, in this aircraft it doesn't have Hobbs, it has the tachometer, but in the Piper Cherokee, it's got a Hobbs, and for people watching out there not associated with the club, sometimes when you turn the electrical on, your Hobbs will start ticking as well. So one thing we can do is pull out our phones and actually dial Falcon ATIS. It's a phone number, and that phone number for Falcon Field in Mesa, Arizona is 480-641-9378. So we're gonna go ahead and call them right now, and we'll see what that sounds like. Have a piece of paper out, get ready to write this down. Typically a sticky note or, you know, your knee board is great.
Nose to airman, crane 0.5 nautical miles north, 120 feet ATO. Crane 0.1 nautical mile north, 110 feet ATO. Has this weather information for Arizona available on flight service frequency. Arrivals south of runway centerline contact tower 124.6. Arrivals north of runway centerline contact tower 119.7. Advise on initial contact, you have X-ray. Falcon Tower information, X-ray 17540 Zulu, wind 1806, temperature 28.22, altimeter 29998. Remark, occasional lightning, distant west. Visual approaching use, landing runway 22 left, 22 right. Nose to airman, crane 0.5 nautical miles north, 120 feet ADL, crane Crossing 0.1 nautical mile north, 110 feet ATO. Has this weather information for Arizona available on flight service frequency. Arrivals south of runway centerline contact tower 124.6. Arrivals north of runway.
So we hang up, we've written that down, we have information X-ray. Now we can continue because the initial check you can see after doing the I'm safe checklist, so that's your pilot internal check after you do that. We've got our weather, now we can go do our density altitude check. So now with that weight and balance sheet that we just saw with our ATIS information that we just got, now we can go run our performance calculations and get our density altitude. Next step that I always do is I check the fuel. I actually even do that coming to the airplane, just walking up, because if we need to call a fuel truck, we can do that right away. And then do the rest of this checklist while we're waiting on fuel. So we can also, you know, obviously we'll follow the checklist as well, but if you know that you're full up and you got, you know, full tanks, you can do the calculation based on that. Find your density altitude, and then that will also help tell you your performance calculations for the day. So that's all done. That should all be done before you turn on the airplane. So next is your Hobbs time. So how do we verify Hobbs time? In this airplane, again, we don't have a Hobbs. We have our tachometer. So we'll look at the tach and we'll verify that. For Aviation Explorers, there's a bin in the back, and that's what this looks like. The pertinent information is your tachometer time, your tachometer end, your Hobbs time. We don't have in this aircraft. So again, the best thing to do is look at the clock, start your stopwatch, or look at the time and jot it down when you actually start the engine. And that is an accurate way of counting your time. Also verify the proper aircraft, because you have to look at the tachometer and you have to verify, okay, that is correct at 66.4. Because if it's not, then when we look at our maintenance sheets, which are in the binder as well, we'll see that maybe there's a maintenance event coming up, and that's how we know that we shouldn't overfly. So verify your tach times, verify your hob times, and then once you do that, there's also a spot in here to check for flat spots. So if you see a flat spot that's new, you can write yes. If you don't see one, you can just mark a line through it. So any flat spots, notate that on your pre-flight walk around. That's a really good way to do it. And then just notate on pre-flight. So once you do that, you remove the control lock on this airplane. Typically in Skyhawks, there's a control lock right here. You can see that there's this little dot. It's actually a hole that's bored into the yoke. And there's typically a control lock that goes right there. This airplane is hangared, so we don't have to worry about tie downs. We don't have to worry about a control lock. We do chalk the wheel. If your airplane is not tied down, always use a control lock and always tie down your airplane very, very well. Because right now there's currently a weather system moving through Phoenix, and yesterday an airplane that's not the club's plane, but somebody else's privately owned aircraft actually blew over, ripped clear free of the chains, and it's upside down, totally trashed right now. So make sure that the control lock is in solid and that the tie downs are there. Next, ignition switch off, and the other call out on this is key removed. So the best way to do that I teach my students is put it up on the dash on the panel right there. So that way when we're doing the walk around, we can all see it. That's a good option. Right now I'm looking at the key on the bulletin board over there, so I know it's out of the aircraft. But like I said, if there were a student or I was actually doing this for a real flight, key would go up on the dash so we can see it the whole time we're doing the walk around. Once we do that, we verify that our avionics switch is off. We don't really have any. So you'll notice that these radios are not avionics, it's just radios. They turn on when the airplane does. So there's no specific avionics switch. Typically you'll have an avionics switch. The other airplane has it on the panel. There's no GPS or anything like that that we have to worry about. So a good way to make sure, again, there's no master avionics switch to turn off. So what we do is we turn each individual avionics switch off. So this is the volume knob. And if it's turned up, you just verify that that's turned down and you can hear it click. So do that on both, verify that they're turned off, verify that your ADF is turned off. And once that is done, your avionics are off. Now that's because the next item is turn your master switch on. So now we turn the master switch on and you'll hear the panel start to come to life. You see a light turn on up there. You see a light turn on down here. You can hear it again. And the next thing to do is check our fuel quantity. So again, I do the fuel quantity check walking up to the airplane. This plane just got back from a check ride prep flight. So it's lower on fuel. But you can see here that this is almost empty on the left tank. The right tank is actually showing just about the same. So they're getting pretty low there, about a quarter of a tank, and then we'll visually verify with that dipstick as well and make sure that we know how much fuel exactly is on board before we take off. Now, if we need a call for a fuel truck, again, we do that. We can keep doing the rest of this checklist while the fuel truck is on the way, because that might take a while. The next step is set fuel selector to both. And you'll notice that right now it's on the left tank. That's because on our shutdown checklist on this aircraft, it says fuel selector set left or right. So it's set to the left tank. That's just kind of standard here at the Aviation Explorer. So for this checklist item, we will do that, put it on both. And the important thing, any airplane when you're switching fuel selectors, is you want to feel the click, you want to feel it in the detent. So basically there's a little detent, like a notch, and what you're doing is moving this pipe essentially over. So your selector valve is opening and it's gonna notch into that. So then when you push it, it's notching out and feeling smooth, and then it'll notch in and drop. So that's what we wanna hear. That's what we want to feel anytime we're doing a fuel selector change. So there's left in the detent, you can hear the click. Both in the detent, click. Right in the detent, click. And then one last one that I like to do is always verify that you can shut off the fuel. So go fuel off. In the detent, you hear the click. So we'll set that fuel selector to both. Both is in the detent. We felt that, we've also heard it, so that's verified. Next is flaps extend down. This airplane's a little unique because it's got this, which is your wing flap selector. It's actually spring loaded, and if you're retracting flaps, it clicks up and stays there. So you have to make sure that it's neutral, and then you can see when we push it, it just spring loads back to the starting neutral position. This is your flap indicator right here that initially goes to 40 degrees of flaps, except this has an STC on it, so it only goes to 30 degrees. So to drop those flaps, we go ahead and we just hold down, and you'll see that flap indicator start to move. We can also say the wing flaps move and visually verify that, and then it stops right there at 30 degrees, and that is full flaps down. The next thing to check is lights, and we want to make this fairly quick. We have our lights right here, so we'll go ahead and select those on, do a fast walk around, come back, turn those off, and then continue on the checklist. So pitot heat we will turn on as well with this check to check that. Nav lights on, beacon lights are on, and you see it's on to strobe. And then landing lights we will also check on. Starting in front, we're verifying that the landing light is on. That's a nice LED, so that doesn't have a huge power draw. And we can also see from here that that strobe light in back is functioning properly. Now, as we're doing this walk around, we're checking the general condition of the aircraft, the cleanliness of the wings. We do clean the leading edge of the wing as well as the glass, or the plexiglass rather, every single flight. So that should be in good condition. Now here we have this red nav light. Red is on the left side of the aircraft with that ADS-B fin, that thing that looks like a shark fin coming down. And that is how air traffic control knows where we are. So we have to have that on for all operations, our navigation lights, and then that will ensure that the ADS-B is working. So we've got our strobe right there. That's still an older strobe, so that has some sort of power draw. That's a little bit more than an LED. But here you can see that we're on this LED rear navigation light, which is white. So white for rear, red for left, and then green for right. Now walking over on the wing, we come around to this side and this should be green, and it is. And again, that's a nice new LED, so that doesn't have a huge power draw. But because of this this tail beacon over here that's flashing, that strobe, and just generally running the battery, we're going to now hop back in the airplane, turn those switches off, and keep running the checklist. So now the lights off. One more thing we have to check, you'll notice, is the pitot heat. Now on a day like today, we might actually want pitot heat if it starts to rain or something and we're flying VFR. So you just come over here, generally feel around here, you can already feel heat radiating off. These do get really, really hot because there's a heating element inside. So that we know is working. You can also just gently tap it, but that's almost to the point where it's burning you, so you can feel it just about that close. You don't have to actually touch it. And again, if you do, just be very, very careful. And most of the time, that is not required. So with that, we can turn the pitot heat off, come back to our checklist. And the next step on the checklist right here is check beacon day, all lights night. We included the pitot heat with that. Master switch now is going off. So then we're going to look at the aircraft documents. We already did that, and I do that because at the beginning, because I don't want to find out that something's missing and then waste my time on a walk around, but we've done that. So that is complete. Next is squawks, item not working in the aircraft. So we look for open squawks, so anything in the scheduling system that somebody's reported that has not been resolved. We look on the panel, and we make sure that it's clear of in-op placards, and in this aircraft, it does not look like we have any. If something weren't working, like if, for instance, you know, something went out that wasn't required, like this is not required, if these stopped working, or if a radio panel stopped working, you would write in-op, inoperative, like a sticker on there, and then take care of that procedure per the federal aviation regs. There's no open squawks on this aircraft, so we're going to keep moving. Now, exterior pre-flight, this is the walk-around. This is where we hop outside and we actually do the walk-around and verify today's current airworthiness and safety of flight on the aircraft. This whole checklist has to be done before every single flight. Every time the engine turns off, before it turns on again, this checklist has to be done. You'll notice it also says weight and balance. We've checked that. Performance, we've already checked that. And then once the aircraft is out of the hangar, we'll do a final walk around. So we'll do the pre-flight walk around, make sure that that's good, pull the aircraft out, make sure that again, that's good. We didn't nick a wing or anything pulling that out of the hangar, and then we will be ready to fly. Now that we have the checklist and we've done the inside pre-flight portion of this, it says to do our exterior pre-flight walk around. Now this exterior pre-flight walk around on this Aviation Explorer's checklist is not here, so that's why I'm making this video to show you a general overview and work with your instructor again for more specifics. Or if you're not part of the Explorer Post, contact an instructor, call us at DW Aviation or visit dwaviation.us. Always happy to help you and explain a little bit more about what's going on here and give you some personalized instruction. You will find this exterior walk around pre-flight in the Cessna POH that's with this airplane, the pilot operating handbook, and it has a diagram with the airplane and little points to walk around. So we can follow that and go through and just make sure that we've covered all our bases. One thing I always tell all of my students is do not trust what I say in its entirety, because I'm a human, I might be wrong. Do not trust what anybody else says about legalities and airworthiness, because that might be a myth or a legend or something they learned incorrectly. Always go back to your official source. If you have a doubt, look at the federal aviation regulations about airworthiness, and you can look at if something's broken or you have a minimum equipment list, that's federal aviation reg 91.213. You can go look at that. For required equipment, that's 91.205. For what you're required to do as pilot in command before the flight, 91.103. Regs will have everything in there that you need to know, but for the actual specifics of how to fly the aircraft, always, always go to your pilot operating handbook. So when we get out of the airplane, we want to look where we're at. So we've got this wing strut and we also have our landing gear coming down. So we're going to look and make sure that the step is secured on there and that all of this looks like it's in good condition. We're going to look at the brake line, make sure that that brake line is clean and that we don't have any leakage. Brake fluid is typically red when it's new, but it could get dirty and brown or black even. So just make sure that there's no leaking. We're gonna check the tire. We're not just looking at the top part of the wheel. We're looking all around. We're looking for flat spots. And I don't see any on this airplane. This did have some last time I flew this, so this must be a brand new tire. We're looking for this tread, making sure that that's a good thickness there, that we can actually see tread, and we don't see wear bars going across the tire of any sort. Specifically here on the outside still, we're making sure that the inflation is good. This does get a little dirty, so sometimes you can do this with gloves if you prefer. The big thing on this is we're looking to make sure that this little stem sticking out does have a cap on it, so we're not losing air. And the big thing is we're making sure that right here, that's a cotter pin, that this cotter pin is in on the wheel assembly. And then you can also look here and make sure that these nuts are secure. It's in good condition. And generally there's no nicks, scratches, cuts, things like that. And that the rubber is still good and sticky. You don't want to see dry rot or like any little spider webbing or anything like that running across. If you have a condition about or a question about the condition of your tire, always ask your instructor. It is better to be safe than sorry and lose a tire when you're landing or taking off. Right here, we're also gonna check the brake pads and make sure that the pads are still good, nice and thick, and that the brake disc is clean as well. Then we're gonna look, and these do have safety wire on them on the bolts there, so that looks great. The brake line all the way going up again is clean, and that looks good. Next, we can come over here and look at the strut, and you see that this has a little foothold on that, and that's secured. We can give it a quick little shake and make sure that the landing gear does in fact hold it, that there's good cushion, that we do have that cushion of air there on the front nose wheel, and that everything looks good. Next thing that we can look at right in front of us is the pitot tube. And we're just looking at the pitot tube, making sure that there's no bugs or grass or anything sticking out. If you don't see anything, that's good. If you do see something, call a mechanic. Don't ever blow into the pitot tube or do anything to it. And then we're also looking and making sure that the drain hole underneath there is in fact clear. Next, we're looking at the static port, and that static port is also clear. That's part of the same pitot static system. While we're here, we can look and make sure that this air inlet is clear. The handle is good and that's holding on secure. That in the air inlets here on the wing, that there's no like bugs or wasp's nests or anything like that. And again, that everything just looks clean, that the door hinges are on properly, and that all looks secure. Big important thing is also make sure that these fastener screws are in into the cowl and these fasteners on top. And this aircraft, it does not have a minimum equipment list, so we're required to have all of those for safe, legal flight. Coming over here, this is the inlet for the stall warning indicator, and there's not a tab or something that we can really mess around with, so you just have to look in there and make sure that that's clear. There's not really a way to test that on the ground. Some of them you can push up on the tab and it will make a noise, but not on this one. So we're verifying that inspection plates are all in, that that all looks good, that the wing doesn't have any dents or damage. Now as you're coming underneath the wing, we actuate the control surfaces. You want to make sure there's nobody in the airplane, and then you can push up on one of these structural points where there are rivets. You can see that throughout here. Push up, make sure that the yoke turns, and then you can just again do the same thing. Gently on two points, pull down, make sure that the other aileron goes up, the yoke turns the other way. While this aileron's up, you verify that these counterweights are all in there and secure. We also are taking a look at the piano joint hinges way back there, making sure that those are in line, that again, there's a cotter pin or safety wire in the end, and that all the bolts are there properly. Now we shift our focus down the wing a little bit, and we get to this push rod, this actuator rod. We make sure that that nut is on there secure, and just make sure again that the condition of everything is good. Then a little bit farther down, those piano hinges on the aileron are also secured properly as well. On these wing flaps, we first want to push on the base where it's structurally sound right there, just a light push. Make sure that that is going to hold an aerodynamic load. Next thing we do is we look at these rollers and make sure that those are greased and the track is clear. Look in here, make sure that that looks greased as well, nothing scraping, nothing scratching. And then there's again another push rod right here, so we make sure that that's on. A little bit of play like that is normal, but we're checking to make sure that the nut is screwed on there securely. Continuing on, we make sure that the baggage door is closed, that this is all in great condition. We're checking antennas as we go along, rivets, to make sure that all the rivets in the aircraft are here. And then we get to the tail section. This horizontal stabilizer is attached to the body of the aircraft. This is the elevator, and on this aircraft, it's the exact same on both sides, with the exception of your trim tab right here. So we're first going to, on a structural part of this right here, the horizontal stabilizer, give it a little light shake. Just make sure that the aircraft is not showing any separation right there or wiggle room. Then we're going to come over and actuate the elevator, and you want to go on a structural component right here, not grab it at the end right there, not grab the fairing, but lightly on both points, move it up and just verify that that's moving with the elevator or the yoke. And as we're doing that, we're watching this to make sure that it's moving at the same pace relative to that motion, because that trim tab is set. So you can see that that is working properly. We come over here to the rudder, and we just want to push again slightly on this structural part with the rivets. Don't actually push and actuate, but we just want to make sure there's tension and that those tension rods or the tension cables are holding. And then we can look down and also just verify that that all looks good within there. Now on the rudder, sometimes you will see a slight bend right there. That's something that typically the mechanic does, and that just helps with some of the aerodynamics on these Skyhawk Cessna 172 airplanes. And then if we look in here, we can see and again just verify connections and general condition of that section of the aircraft. Then we're going to do the same thing, just walking around the other side of the airplane. It's the same as the other side with the exception of the pitot static system, verifying everything works, and then we're going to finish our checklist. We're checking on the spinner to make sure that the spinner is straight, that it's not drooping or sagging or turned any which direction, which might be problematic. We're checking the leading edge of this propeller to make sure that the leading edges are smooth and that there's no nicks or scratches or dings. Little things like that just on the paint are fine. What we're concerned with are like if that scratch were deep or if I could get my fingernail in there, that could actually compromise the structural integrity of the propeller. Now, we're also checking to make sure that all the screws are on here. Every single screw has to be on the entire cowl if there's any screws missing. Unless it's in the type certificate or this has a minimum equipment list, it is not airworthy. If one screw is missing from anywhere on here, you cannot fly this airplane. Same thing with rivets. If any of these rivets are missing, you cannot fly. Now we have to get inside here to check and make sure that the alternator belt right there is good and that everything looks good. There's no oil that's exploded inside and things like that. That's why we put the key on the dash so we can see it. Again, here are the keys on the whiteboard, but we know that it is at least secured. So that being said, if we ever have to turn the propeller, we always want to turn it with the direction that the propeller spins. And just be aware, again, because we need to check either this leading edge, if it's up top, or check inside here. So sometimes you might need to spin it, but be aware that this may have something like a broken ground wire for the magneto. Any aircraft is a potential that the propeller could kick, and you do not want to be in front of this propeller if it does start. Again, it shouldn't start and continually run, but there have been instances where people go to hand prop. That's why hand propping is a terrible idea and you never should do that. But sometimes you do have to move the propeller, so be aware. So the proper form for this is you grab the propeller and you're going to push it this direction, but you do this basically so you're stepping away from the aircraft. So you're anticipating, even though it usually won't, it should never kick and start, you're always going to go to spin this and then fall away from it. So that way, if it does start, you are at least facing out and you're walking away from the prop. Now that it's here though, you can also feel that it's got some great compressions, but now we're looking at this alternator belt. This is the alternator and this belt connects to the alternator. You can see that it goes up here. These little teeth are the flywheel for the starter, so we're verifying that these teeth all look clean and that they're not nicked or damaged and that they all look uniform. With the alternator belt, we're verifying that it's still spongy like rubber. Again, we're looking and making sure screws are all there. And then one other important thing is anytime there's something securing anything in, like this bolt right here, we're making sure that this little wire is connected and that in fact it does have that safety wire twisted tight like that and in there properly and securely. That's hugely important to make sure that nothing falls out and becomes foreign object debris or FOD. Then we're also just looking at the general condition and popping our heads kind of down and inside to right about here, looking and making sure that all the pushrod housings are secure, that there's no oil or anything leaking. If you do see oil leaking out of the cowl or something looks wrong to you, talk to your instructor, and that is definitely a topic to go over. Now that we've checked the spinner, we've checked the alternator belt and the inside, we're gonna look down here at this quadrant. And what we're looking for is on this air intake filter that the bolts are secure, that the filter is in there secure. Again, that all our rivets are there and everything is fastened. Here, we're gonna make sure that that has a nice ring to it, that we don't see any cracks. If we see any cracks, that could be potentially a dangerous situation for carbon monoxide or exhaust getting in the cockpit. We're looking and making sure that there's no oil spitting out onto the cowl. This is the bottom of the cowl, so make sure that there's no oil coming out. We're looking at the tires, and again, same thing as the other tires, that there's tread, that there's no bald spots, that this has a cap, and anytime there's a securing nut, we're looking for either a cotter pin or safety wire. Both of these have a cotter pin. We're also looking up here and making sure that these joints have nuts on them, that everything here is properly secured, and that those actuator rods are again secured as well. This is a shimmy damper right here, so basically that helps reduce the shake in this wheel. These Skyhawk wheels are notorious for shaking, so if you're landing, keep that back pressure on, keep the nose wheel basically unloaded, and that will help with that. We're also looking here to make sure we have at least 3 fingers worth. 4 is ideal, and we do have a minimum of 4 fingers worth on the strut. Sometimes this will settle down, and I've seen planes riding on that with absolutely no air cushion, and that is not safe to fly. So if that is low, stop your flight, talk to the mechanic, and get that filled up, please. Next thing while we're here is we can also go ahead and remove this, the chalk, and on this airplane, we can just keep it to the side like that. It will not be hit by the gear on the side. But as you step this plane back into the hangar using that winch, it's just a really, really good way to make sure that we're stopping where the airplane needs to stop and that we're over this oil pan just in case it does drip. With the Aviation Explorers, we are required to use the winch to pull the airplane back. So the first step you do when you're pulling the airplane back in is you disengage with that latch so that way you can pull this cable out freely. Just watch yourself with the handle. Once you have enough room, you take the big carabiner attach it to the tail hook of that aircraft carefully, and then you can re-engage the winch and start cranking it back. Now, slowly, this will help you pull the airplane back in. Once you get it to a point where it's in, it's over the hump, and you've gotten it securely in the hangar, you can disengage this carabiner off the tail hook and put it to the side. Thanks everyone for watching. I hope this helped with your Cessna 172 walk around tutorial. Like I said, if you have any questions and you're 14 to 20, contact the Aviation Explorers. If you have any other questions, call us or go to dwaviation.us. We're happy to address any concerns or questions. And if you're interested to fly, find your own flight instructor, get out there and start doing this stuff. Thanks, fly safe, and have a great day.